101 things every investor should know about the global economy. I'm gonna read this. This was a free download from the U.S. Trust YouTube video. Their latest video. Alright. It says, making sense of a transforming world. It's 36 pages. So, civil unrest in the Middle East, a depression in Greece, a structural slowdown in China, the rise of Africa, a game-changing energy revolution in the United States. The only constant in the global economy is change. What is true today was not true yesterday. While the contours of tomorrow remain murky and ill-defined, such are the turbulent and ever-shifting global cross-currents investors find themselves in at the moment. In other words, that's just another way of saying in the rapids of thought, known as contrast. Okay, the global investment landscape is always fluid. Choppy, but never before have U.S. investors had to disentangle and decipher so many conflicting signals from various parts of the globe. Never before have investors had to cope with the stunning velocity of information that circles the planet at warp speed. And never before have investors had to digest so much matter and chatter from 24/7 media outlets, leaving many not surprisingly ill at ease about investing and ill-advised about what's really going on in the world. Alright, so here we have a picture of the media, which for the most part is being rehabilitated as we speak, so that the media speaks 100% truth. And no more hearsay. and no more suggestion to mislead. It's mislead citizens within the countries. To decipher so many conflicting signals, that's what you call being in the rapids of thought, which is contrast, which is which takes awareness to realize that you're in the contrast of thought rapids. And so we want to bring ourselves out of those thought rapids if it's getting too dangerous. The rapids are too dangerous. We need to paddle to shore. Or if we can maneuver the thought rapids, to maneuver them and set new desires while in the contrast, to embrace them. Now, in order to get ashore, all we have to do is ground ourselves. The shore is called ground. So, while we are in the imagination of thought, and it's too much for us to handle, immediately bring ourselves out of the rushing river of thought in our lower brain, and that would be the cerebellum, and bring our bring our inner eye and our outer eye into attentive agreement with our surroundings. That's just another way of saying, look at the walls, look at your hand. If you're outside, look at the trees, the birds, the sky, all of nature. You have to ground yourself. You have to give your ears and eyes something to look at. Otherwise, you get washed away by the power of the thought rapids. So that's that paragraph. Next paragraph. It all used to be a lot simpler for U.S. investors, notably for America's baby boomers. When the boomers entered the labor force, the preeminent economy in the world was the United States. China was poor and closed. The Soviet Union held a huge swath of Central and Eastern Europe under lock and key. A huge swath of Central and Eastern Europe, and Europe under lock and key. Across many sectors, U.S. firms were the most competitive in the world. America was a creditor, not a debtor nation. There were no smartphones, nor iPads, or even laptop computers to disrupt and distract the lives of millions of Americans. Finally, investment choices for investors were rather elementary and unsophisticated. A house and a company pension were the retirement foundation of most working Americans. Now, that last sentence right there confirms to us that the United States was not a debtor nation, as says in the paragraph. And because anybody who is relying on benefits from the pirate corporation, or the pirate side of the corporation being the United States, you have to remember, as this PDF is being written, there are both potential princes of peace, and there are actual princes of peace. So instead of calling them pirates, we'll call them potential princes of peace. And there are real princes of peace. So, baby boomers, that would be, I am a baby boomer. These are people that were... Well, I'm not a baby boomer, I'm Generation X. And I am a baby of the baby boomers. My parents would be baby boomers. So, it all used to be a lot simpler, notably for American baby boomers, when the boomers entered the labor force. Okay, the labor force was already in effect, and that was happened in 1933, the clincher of the labor force, where everybody was put on a benefit plan. In other words, the assumption of jurisdiction was cemented in the hearts of the American people, and says here, China was poor, Soviet Union held a huge swath of Central and Eastern Europe, and under lock and key, U.S. firms, the most competitive in the world. America was the creditor, not the debtor nation. It says America was the creditor, not the debtor nation. That is a twist of words right there. United States, known as United States of America, corporation. It's all the same name. It's all corporation. The United States was not the creditor. Never has been. No corporation has ever been a creditor. All corporations were created as debtors, and they were purposely put into the debtor situation permanently by way of a series of bankruptcies. But it was a good thing. In order to provide a distribution of resources on the earth, a birth certificate application bond had to be created so that people could orderly have a piece of the pie, and it could be distributed out to the world through the various distribution points, delivery systems and whatnot, ships, planes, automobiles, 18-wheelers brought to the cities, and it's just a big giant accounting system. That's all it is. And yes, more than likely, in this paragraph here, it says U.S. firms were the most competitive in the world. America I just want to say also that the people are the creditor. The people were the creditor in this U.S. trust letter. But just keep in mind that for the sake of reducing or keeping any riots from happening, these reports are written in veiled terms. So all we have to do is remove the veil using private maritime law, and everything's laid naked before us. So, U.S. firms were the most competitive in the world back then. That's easy to believe, because the U.S. was the ones that won the wars. So, all the rest of the countries were destroyed in war. The only thing that was destroyed in the United States was Pearl Harbor. So, and we easily recovered from that. There were no smartphones, iPads, or laptop computers to disrupt and distract the lives of million Americans. Yeah, it is true that all these technical achievements have brought about distraction, but they've also made life easier. It's a balance of natural law and technology, east and west, that we're striving for, and that takes time. But in the meantime, yes, technology has been a disruption and a distraction from finding balance. That's the main thing, is balance. Finally, investment choices. Investors were rather elementary and unsophisticated. A house and a company pension were the retirement. Okay, so that's self-explanatory there. Next paragraph. Today, it's a great deal more complicated, albeit one of the largest and most competitive economies in the world. America is no longer the lone global alpha dog. The competition has become more intense and unrelenting. China is opening up and getting wealthier and more influential by the day. The 28-member European Union is no economic lightweight. Indeed, it ranks as the largest economy entity in the world. The U.S. consumer still matters to global growth, but the emerging market consumer will matter even more in the years and decades. Now, when it says that the United States is no longer in the lead and that other companies are catching up to it, well, that's what we want. We want everybody to be at the same level as the United States, because when we're all at the same level of understanding at at the using the Illuminati knowledge and the Freemasonry knowledge, which is the laws of the universe. When everybody, every nation starts to embrace the Illuminati, the laws of the universe, then we see that the king is not there to rule over everyone, which would be the United States. The king is there to help everyone get to the same level. So naturally, all nations in the world will become equal, in equal power. That's why we have the one world order. All nations are considered equal. So that's that one was easy to decipher. And that by way of the spread of democracy through the law, of the strong arm of the law, which is the United States military, which has bases in every country, and we are the leader of the military force that keeps order in the earth and the planet. The competition has become more and more intense and unrelenting. There is competition, but that competition is just natural artistry in function. And the potential princes of peace who have yet to understand this are still grappling with that outlook. China is opening up and getting wealthier and more influential day by day. We said that. All countries will be getting... Hi, June. I'm a little friend. The European Union, yeah. Okay, so we covered that paragraph pretty good. Next paragraph. By living beyond its means for years, the U.S. is now a debtor nation, not a creditor nation. It's China and Japan. The pace of technical charge only change. The pace of technical change only continues to accelerate, destroying old firms and creating new players with the power to disrupt the economic status quo. once again, the United States was purposely watered down so that we could send some of our countries over to the struggling countries that have been destroyed by war, so that we could get them strong. And it's the old father-son idea, where, you know, the son is this wrestling with his child, and the father will play weak, and he'll say, "Oh, you got me, you know. So this is to build the confidence up of the child, and the child says, "Ah, I'm feeling strong, I'm feeling worthy, I'm feeling a sense of, you know, honor." And so, you know, that's what you do, that's a natural process that you do with those that are weak. Instead of snuffing out the weak, which is the kill or kill be world of the jungle, and the reason why we entered into this prison planet system, which has a third and final mind shift phase to it, we make ourselves weak on purpose, give the appearance of weakness, so that other nations can get strong. And then we just automatically get stronger right beside them, and everybody's at the same level. Once able to set the tune for the global economy, America increasingly finds itself a co-maestro to China, the G20, or Europe. The U.S. economy has rarely been as open or exposed to external influence as it is today. We are dependent on the world's natural resources, human capital, savings, technology, and markets, to name just a few. That is another way of saying that when things go bad in Europe or China, or unexpectedly turn for a better, a la accelerating growth in Africa, the aftershocks are quickly transmitted to the shores of the United States. Now, we know that the United States has the power to transform itself from the weak, lean-looking dad who's wrestling with his children, lets his children get strong. We know that the United States will show itself in equal strength to the children. So to speak, you know, not really children, fellow brothers. All nations are fellow brothers. And because of the potential princes of peace who have displayed more of the female side of the cerebellum, which is the impulsive, instinctual, bite and scratch first mentality, and then think later. Because of that, the United States and the rest of the world are in that situation that they're in today, which is a good situation, like I said. For you, now remember, all of this is just the power of thought. When you read all this information on this that I'm reading you, it's telling you the truth, but it's also sharing contrast with you. So you automatically set new dreams in your mind, new desires, moment by moment, as I read each word. Now, page one, the last sentence is, for U.S. investors, the risk and rewards of a more open and integrated global economy are tremendous, but exploiting these opportunities and managing the attendant risk require a more fundamental understanding of the global economy. How it works, leads and lags, who does what better than the others, and on down the line. We think of the global economy as a singular entity, and in one sense it is. Yeah, it's all one corporation. Mother Earth is all we have to work with when it comes to a living and breathing entity. That's true. The corporations that depend on Mother Nature for her raw materials to be distributed to all the people equally, their equal share of the birth certificate application bond. That said, the global economy consists of many different parts and components. The countries, companies, and citizens of the world are very diverse and dispersed, having different attributes, endowments, and capabilities that make for a very complicated and messy risk-reward profile for investors, hence the need for this research. Okay, let's read that one again. Mother Earth is all we have to work with when it comes to living and breathing that entity. That said, the global economy consists of many different parts and components. The countries, companies, and citizens of the world are very diverse and dispersed, having different attributes, endowments, and capabilities that make for a complicated and messy risk-reward profile. Now, just replace that word messy with the word potentially. Everything is a potential. If we view our life's situations as messes, then the universe will attract to us a mess. But if we view every situation as a potential, then naturally potential reaps a harvest of settlement and equality. So like I said, words are just containers. Or like I said in my latest Trinity Broadcasting Network Bishop T.D. Jakes video, which which I did go to the YouTube TBN Network video YouTube channel, and T.D. Jakes is the star as of we speak at this moment. So yeah, even though we, as I wrote in one of the comments to the latest T.D. Jakes video, I said, words are just containers. Just as all corporate names are the same, all words that we use are the same. All words, all sounds that we make are the same. A baby's cry is no different from a person making a sentence, speaking a sentence or speaking words, audible words, with his lips, whether they be Pentecostal tongues, or whether they be legible words like, I will go to the store and buy products today. That's a sentence example. Because it's all intention. Remember, words are just containers. And it is the intention of our third eye that we use, which is called the Holy of Holies. That's where the Ark of the Covenant is, where the mercy seat is. It is our intention. That is where our intention is born. So it doesn't matter what words we actually use. It is our intention that brings an attraction of the universe back to our lives. But I just want to say this. For the sake of maintaining peace and safety, it is best to use the most healthiest words possible, due to the fact that not all people yet are knowledgeable of the ancient Illuminati knowledge, which says that all words are the same, and it is our intention behind the words that matters. So, if we were to say everything is messy in the world, well, people who don't understand how to navigate the rushing rapids of thought will be in danger of injury as they themselves get pulled into the fork of the river, of the nice, calm, smooth river. They all of a sudden come to a fork in the river, and they choose the river that have been attracted to them, and they find themselves going through the rapids of thought, and they could they might, as they going through, fall off the raft and sink into the waters, being slammed against the rocks into the legal world of death, injury, and possibly death. So, instead of calling this, and as it says in this piece of paper here, let's read it again, that make for a very complicated and messy risk and reward profile, we could say that make for a very, instead of calling it complicated, we can call it simple. Because if we call it complicated when it is actually very simple at its root, then that word also causes people to go into the fork of the river and attract to themselves, turning onto the fork that leads to the rapids of thought. And so we have the word complicated and messy are words that, when spoken into the atmosphere onto the average ear, causes the average ear to view the whole world as a complicated and messy place. And like I said, without the proper knowledge to create their own realities with their intentions, with their desires, they haven't yet the natural knowledge to use these particular words, such as complicated and messy. They haven't the knowledge to use these particular words as contrast. And when we talk about contrast, we're talking about the ability to create a new desire, a goal, a light at the end of the tunnel, to tape a picture to the wall of how you want to see the world be. And the way we want to see the world be, for the most part, is to all have access to that birth certificate application bond, and all nations to be equal in getting their share of the distribution system, through the distribution system, their share of Mother Nature's milk. Which milk is just a word for all products, all resources on the earth necessary to keep the body healthy, prosperous, and to enter into the eternal life. So we'll finish with this video right here, and we'll move on to the next phase.